here tonight would just like to know something else about God that you may not have known. Just one more piece.
Yes, please.
That you may not have known.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So what I want you to do silently as I open up with this introduction, I want you to pray, this is very serious, that the Lord will open up your spiritual mind to receive his spiritual things.
Yes.
Because flesh can't discern spirit.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
ma'am. Flesh cannot discern spirit. And God honors our praise and worship. He honors our devotion to him. He honors our commitment and all of what you have given back. And we've heard the message, give me what you got. But God wants to give you more. And he's going to give you more. But flesh cannot discern the things of the Spirit. So we need to ask God continually to help us move ourselves out the way so he can pour into us. The subject of our lesson tonight is God. Everything emanates from him. The Bible and science go hand in hand.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, ma'am.
Go hand in hand.
Yes.
Science does not prove the Bible is correct. It explains in detail its validity.
Right. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Science already knows God exists.
Yes.
Science. But God has left just a little bit of knowledge, which we call science, to give you in detail.
Yes.
His existence. God has allowed science as man's method to figure things to a degree. It pacifies inquiring minds and it satisfies the faithful. Our thoughts are not his thoughts, and our ways are not his ways. Natural things cannot discern spiritual. But God has allowed revelation knowledge and his creation to speak, as it were,
yes,
to our desire to know him.
Yes, ma'am.
Through the word of God, we know him. Through science, we glorify him.
Yes!
That's good.
But in order for us to be in order, the best way we can gauge thought and perception is to start at the beginning.
Yes.
So let's begin pre-Genesis. Now, I want to introduce to you the scientific teacher tonight, because everything that he's going to share with you, I'm going to share with you biblically. Everything he's going to share with you scientifically,
yes,
it is going to match biblically.
Yes.
Now, you have to understand this, that God is the Word.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
In the beginning was the Word,
yes,
and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then the 13th verse says, and the Word came from God and dwelt among them. But we're going to share some things that are spiritual and that are natural. Now, you may not be able to even repeat this to someone else, but your soul will be satisfied.
Yes.
Your soul will be satisfied. And now turn it over into the hands of Professor
Romero.
Yes. I got a little skit, so that's why he has that name.
Okay.
All right, Professor.
All right, Professor.
Praise the Lord, Saint.
Praise the Lord.
Praise Him.
The subject matter tonight is something that has been known, and actually has been in the Bible. If you read the Bible, everyone's read the Bible. This has been taught already. At the time that the Bible was being written, he explained to those who wrote the Bible as best that they could understand at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And as our race and our intelligence has grown, we are able to understand more. Or in more accuracy.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go start off with who or what is God? God is the I Am. And the scientific background behind this is you have to go into creation of the universe. What came before the creation? Before the creation of the universe, before he spoke the universe to its existence, there was nothing. This is in quantum physics. They know that before their theory that what happened, there was nothing, and they still are looking for a reason or a cause for their theory. And basically, there are three dimensions that we know of as of right now. We see the linear is the first dimension. That's a linear, so that would be the perception of a two-dimensional object. A two-dimensional object would be me drawing this stick man on the board. Gotta make him happy. Now, if the stick man were to look to his right or to his left and perceive that this other stick man is there, all he would see, since he is a two-dimensional object, is a one-dimensional linear line. That's all he will perceive. The first dimension cannot affect the second dimension. Thus, this stick man can't affect me because I am of the third dimension. Our God is omnidimensional.
Yes, he is.
Yes. Oh my God.
That's good.
He exists in the creation dimension. That is the nothing that we cannot perceive.
Oh my goodness!
Oh my goodness! That's good, sir.
Now, quantum physicists have theorized that there are between 6 to 11 dimensions that they can think of.
Wow.
So, I'm going to use 4. And when I speak of the fourth dimension, I'm not speaking of heaven. I'm speaking of just the creation dimension.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to use it. So what I'm telling you right now is just a simplified version of what I'm saying. So the fourth dimension, we would say, is the nothing, the creation dimension, where all things came from. And if we add this into effect, God has always existed.
Yes, sir.
Now, we can't perceive in our minds nothing.
Right.
Even in space, space is made of something.
Yeah.
So without space being there, nothing, we cannot perceive in our third dimensional minds, nothing at all. So how can we perceive that God had a beginning? There was no beginning. He is the beginning, the source. So what I want to go into is the frequency of creation. Now, to understand frequency, I'm speaking about wavelengths. I'm speaking about energy. Now, we, on a third dimension, experience this every day. We have what's called the Doppler effect.
Yes, Doppler.
When a car goes past you,
yes,
you hear a car go, vroom.
Yeah.
That is the sound waves. Let me draw it out for you real quick. This is the perceiver. This is the point of perception. This is you. This is an object passing you. Now, the sound waves, these are what you call sound waves. These sound waves, at the epicenter, what created the sound, they are more compressed. That's the frequency. The wavelengths are really close together, which you would see here. When sound, as the sound travels, the wavelengths become wider, the frequency becomes less. So that changes the sound. The sound is making the constant sound the entire time, but as the perceiver, as the object moves past the point of perception, this, the Doppler effect is you hear the change in frequency and wavelength.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Now, as you move on into a higher energy base on that, you have a sonic boom. Mm-hmm. A sonic boom is not the absence of sound. It is an object creating sound moving faster than the speed of sound.
Right.
That's why before, as something moving, there will be no line before. This will be completely, if you can see it, the object's still there, sorry. Mm-hmm. But there's nothing before because it's actually moving faster than the speed of sound.
Wow.
So when it reaches the point of perception, mm-hmm. that's when the frequency is heard.
Yes, sir.
So as it reaches you, you don't hear the roar of the engine. You hear the compression of sound exploding in your ears. That's why it's called a sonic boom.
Wow. Okay.
So the frequency of creation. Our language is not God's language. This is a lot of what we've gone through, a lot of hang-ups as humans, deciphering whether God is black or white or a certain race or certain height or certain color or a certain.
Yes.
God is the source.
Yes, he is.
This is a third dimension. We're talking about an omnidimensional being.
Yes.
Do you really think that a human body is going through different dimensions?
Go ahead. Yes, sir.
This is not a shape we're talking about.
This
is the source of all energy.
Yes, he is.
This is a sentient being that has no limitations.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
When God spoke the universe into existence,
Genesis, first chapter, third verse.
Yes.
And God said, "Let there be light."
Light.
When he spoke that to Moses, when he spoke that to him, he did not actually say, "Let there be light." But in the heavenly creation language, he said, "Let there be light." He couldn't make the noise that Moses, that to Moses, to make him understand that I made this sound so that light would come into existence. Because he spoke his language. It's just the same way as if someone speaking English can't go to Spain and understand what they're saying. You can't go to the creation dimension and understand the voice of God.
Wow.
He speaks to us in simplest forms that he created on the third dimension.
Third, yes, yes.
So when he spoke this into existence, if you understand how light and sound works, the relationship is very similar. Light passes and moves around the same frequency as sound. Their wavelengths. The difference between sound and light is pure energy. Sound is created from energy being exhausted, but light is created from the release of energy. This is why light can go on forever and ever and ever. Photons. When you have light, when it starts out, it starts at the red side of the spectrum. When it moves down, the frequency becomes less, and you have it move to the ultraviolet spectrum. This is how light, changing distance, becomes different types of light. You can have, that's how we get ultraviolet rays from the sun, but we see the sun and it's not violet, it's not visible, it's red, it's yellow. We perceive the light because it's at a certain distance. What happens, like what I said earlier, what happens when you have something moving fast, something making a sound moving faster than the speed of sound? You get a sonic boom. The creation of the universe, the vibration of creation, which if we know the way particles work, particles vibrate and vibrate at a certain frequency if you go down to molecular level. If you see H2O, two hydrogen, one oxygen, it looks something like this.
Periodic table? Yeah. Yes. Yes, sir.
And the whole time, we have it vibrating and wiggling in certain directions. Now, there's different kinds of vibration, but it doesn't change the molecular structure.
Wow.
So, when he spoke it to existence, he vibrated at the frequency that took effect on the molecules and created the universe. Now, what I'm going to say right now is going to be really shocking. This is the big point where science and religion come together, and they have not yet decided that it has. But it already did.
Yes.
Light. If sound moves faster, if something making the sound moves faster than the speed of sound, when it reaches the point of perception, it creates a sonic boom. That is the release of all the energy of the sound has been traveling before. When light, since the relation is so similar, can do the same thing. Albert Einstein's general law of relativity. If you move at the speed of light, time stops because space and time are one and the same. Now, when you get something moving, if you get something emitting energy, the source, moving faster than the speed of light, which in our third dimension is not possible, but in a dimensional being, nothing is impossible.
Right.
Mm.
You say you need infinite energy to sustain the speed of light. You get, when it reaches the point of perception, when the light reaches the point of perception, or the energy reaches the point of perception, you have the same effect as a sonic boom, which would be a big boom that created the universe.
So in other words, to clarify or to simplify what he said, we are creationalists, and we know that God created the heavens and the earth. But scientifically, when God spoke in the fourth dimension, by the time it reached the third dimension, it exploded.
Right. Yes.
If you can understand
that. I like that.
So science, if they say we had a big boom, technically they're correct.
Yeah.
But they don't know what caused it.
Yes. Thank you. The creator.
God caused the big boom.
Thank you.
Oh, the world that she existed.
Yes.
But we're going to talk about now infinite energy, the source.
Yes.
Because we know that energy never dissipates. It has always existed. Who has always existed?
God.
Energy can only change form.
Yes.
God is not inhibited. I am.
Yes.
That I am. Hallelujah.
So even though scientists are discovering more and more, they are just giving us a descriptive picture of the person we serve.
Yes.
For our purposes tonight, we are saying that God is in the fourth dimension. And the reason why it's so important for us to have the mind of Christ is because the third dimension cannot affect the fourth dimension unless we have an element in us that is from the fourth dimension. We're going to talk about, first of all, we are new creatures in Christ. We hear that, we've read it, but when we receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, which is all power, all anointing, God Himself dwells in us.
God does not lose capacity because each of us are filled.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jesus.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's good.
God is not lost because all of us are filled. He does not have to recover because he fills all space.
Yes.
That's the God we serve.
That's
good. So it's so important for us to fast and pray.
Yeah.
And I'm going to let the scientists explain that on a scientific level. And then I'm going to go back to we are new creatures in Christ. And while he's talking, you can turn to 2 Corinthians 5:17 and Galatians 6 and 15.
So one thing I want to go, and I did miss, was a lot of people have a question of how is it that God is everywhere at the same time? Just have we explained between the difference between the third and the fourth dimension. They are in the same place. God isn't outside. He's here, vibrating in a frequency that we cannot relate to. This is why you can feel him, but you can't see him.
Oh my goodness.
Yo, professor, that's good.
I'm going to bring it back to you.
Yo,
no man can see God at any time. How do we know he exists? Because we feel
him. Yeah.
Because we pray. And he answers prayer.
Yes.
Why is it so important to have the Holy Ghost? Because the Holy Ghost will make utterances to God that we don't know what is saying.
Yes.
But that same spirit that dwells in us knows that other dimension. And we in our bodies get the benefit of the Holy Ghost praying on our behalf.
That's good.
See, he honors our flesh crying out to him.
Oh, Jesus.
And he knows and understands what we are saying and what we go through, but then there comes a switch. And the switch is you'll start speaking in other tongues. With groanings or sound waves or vibrations which cannot be uttered. This being has given you purpose.
That's good.
The energy source, and I don't want you to misunderstand me. I'm not diminishing who God is by calling him energy, because energy never dies, and God never dies. The source never dies. He is, does not have source. He is source. He doesn't even have resource. He is resource.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, you're going to be new creatures after tonight.
Yes, ma'am.
And or you're going to walk in your new creatureness.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
So to answer the question as how God can be everywhere at the same time, as I'm going to make a similar drawing that like I did at the beginning.
That's so good. Man,
I'm going to do this real simple. Two-dimensional, three-dimensional. Am I still there?
Yep.
This thing cannot perceive three-dimensional. It doesn't know depth.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't know that I am there.
Wow.
But it feels me.
Right.
Wow.
Yes.
Things from one dimension, from a higher
dimension,
can affect lower dimensional items.
Yes.
But you cannot affect, this cannot affect me.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I created it. Therefore, it is.
That's good.
Now, when it comes to prayer and fasting, Prayer and fasting is a necessity. The reason why prayer and fasting is a necessity is because it puts your body, your physical third dimensional body, it forces it into a certain vibration.
Yes.
Wow. You feel a certain way when you,
yes.
when you pray and fast.
Yes.
This is why God said these demons only come out through prayer and fasting.
Yes.
This is why he told us to do this. Because it puts you in a because our flesh desires food, sustenance, to exist. Our energy does not. Your mind, your personality is a series of electrical synapses inside of the brain between your neurons. In essence, you are energy. That is what makes you. You come from God. He is the source. So when you pass on, for all those who have a question of what happens after we die, energy does not dissipate.
Mm-hmm.
This is law. Energy does not dissipate, it transfers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's right.
The energy inside your brain has to go somewhere.
Yes, Jesus.
It vibrates at a different frequency. Your spirit leaves this body.
Yes.
Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
You vibrate at a new, on a new level.
Yes.
You don't see things the way those who do not have the Spirit of God see things. Faith without works is dead. But you can do all things through Christ. Nothing is impossible in the fourth dimension. We limit ourselves when we say, I can't. We limit God from doing anything because he does not micromanage. Jesus told his disciples on several occasions, you will be able to ask the Father anything and it shall be done unto you. And in your natural minds, you say how?
Mm.
Which short circuits the energy.
Wow.
Jesus said, you can speak to this mountain,
yes.
Be thou removed and be cast into the sea,
yes.
And it will be done.
Yes.
But we say how? Someone read Galatians 6 and 15.
For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature.
You are a new creature. Your spirit man is not governed by the laws of the third dimension.
Wow. Wow.
Your Holy Ghost does not get hungry. The Holy Ghost does not get sleep.
No.
The Holy Ghost does not get tired. The Holy Ghost does not give up.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost does not have insecurity problems.
No, he don't.
The Holy Ghost does not,
no, he don't,
not have faith.
Mm-hmm. Jesus.
So what's hindering us?
Us.
Us. Someone quickly read John 15 and 7.
Ye abide in me, and my words abide in you. Ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you.
Does the Bible lie?
No.
Why doesn't this happen in our lives? Because we don't abide or we don't live in him. We visit.
We visit.
We have sabbaticals with Jesus. I mean, this is embarrassing, but we can get it right because we're still breathing.
Yes.
See, our problem is we calculate time. So if we say, I can do all things, and I know that I can do all things through God, when? You don't want to say how, you say when.
Jesus never put a when on it. He said, if you ask anything, it shall be done unto you. He didn't say when. So what we need to do is to continue to walk as if it happened or is going to happen. Because it shall happen. If it does not happen for us in a month, in a week, in a day, in a year, we give up and we doubt. But I'm here to tell you right now, he called Moses at 40. Moses delivered the children at 80. He told us we will do X, Y, Z. And because we didn't do it in a month or a week, we give up. We don't believe. God knows how long you're going to live. But we have to operate at another frequency. But we have to be affected by that God who is omnidimensional, who has all power, who is all-knowing.
Yes.
To add to that, says in the scripture, and this is a scripture that my mother has talked to me about since I was a kid. And it really took hold of me. It said, Enoch walked with God and was not. The conversation, she used to always wonder, she used to say, I wonder what conversation that they were having that made God take Enoch. And it wasn't a conversation. I don't think so. I think that Enoch was vibrating at the heaven frequency. I was a third dimensional being with the mindset of heaven. It's possible. It's possible in our day we haven't changed molecular structure. I don't think we've turned into aliens. We haven't changed into jelly beans. We're the same humans that Enoch, that Moses, that all of them walked the earth.
Please turn to Romans 8 and 13, and someone else turn to Colossians 3 and 5.
For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live.
We have to kill our third dimensional concepts. Because our flesh keeps us from experiencing God in his fullness as much as he will allow in this third dimension. If we continue to think like where we came from, we will never get to where we're going. You have to leave where you are to get where you're going. And a lot of us don't want to leave traditions and experiences and history, and my family was so powerful with this and I accomplished that, and but I was raised this way, and but I believe that way. If you are stuck where you are, how can you get anywhere else? Your job is not to hold on to good times. Your job is to get better and better. And this is very hard for us because if we had a good time in our lives or a good era in our lives or accomplished something, we keep on saying, remember when. And we will go to our graves saying, remember when. And God did not give us memory to stay stuck. We go on to from glory to glory. We've conceded to have what we are familiar with and what's comfortable for us. But so many people have not allowed God to show them the more. So if God is telling you there's more of him, don't hold on to what you did 10 years ago for the Lord.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Don't even hold on to what you learned last week. There's more. Our pastor tells us all the time, there's more. Don't give him the same praise and worship you gave him last week. There's more. Can you imagine what God has in store for all of us on this side of glory? And we stop ourselves because we vibrate at a low level. Someone read Colossians 3 and 5.
Mortify, therefore, your members, which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil,
covetousness, which is idolatry.
Mortify means to kill. It doesn't mean to rest. It doesn't mean to lay aside. Some of us have our little issues in intensive care, on life support, on the respirator, in the closet, in the freezer,
right.
Waiting for someone to get on your nerves so you can unfold.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, some of them aren't ready. You know, some of them we have in the refrigerator, and then some of them are sitting out on the shelf ready.
Ready.
But some of us, we've gotten sophisticated enough to at least freeze our idolatry.
Wow.
We freeze it. So at least it takes a little time for it to come out and unthaw. God wants us to kill these things, so that they won't get in his way of what he's going to do.
I want you guys to think of yourself as a tuning fork. You have to resonate at a certain frequency. I know we've been throwing around that word a lot, frequency. But a tuning fork, depending on its shape, on its size, makes a different tone. This is a I would say this is something that God placed in my heart to talk about. When I was young, I used to pray a lot for peace. Every day, I prayed for peace in my life. And I feel that that's the reason why I understand what I do. Because he said he gives the peace that passes understanding. I got the peace that passes understanding down in my heart. And, I mean, as funny as that is, different activities give you different feelings.
Yeah.
If you feel peace, your mind is at ease and your cup is open for you to receive what he has for you. If you have a warrior spirit, if you are tough, tuning for it, you can take a lot of strikes. You can take the hit and still resonate. Different gifts come with different people because of their actions.
Mm-hmm.
You resonate in a different frequency, all of us. And if you resonate with God, he can work with you.